So welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and today for our LPI Linux Essentials on the Raspberry Pi, we're going to take a look at Python as being one of our major open source applications. Of course, Python is really important to the Raspberry Pi. After all, the name Pi itself comes from Python. Even though it's spelled differently, it is part of its name being Python. You get both Python 2, 2.7 and Python 3, 3.2 included with your Raspbian distribution. It's a scripting language, so we can write our scripts, so text files that are going to process our code. But we can also use it as a console. It's called the REPL console, read, evaluate, print and loop. And we'll stick to the simple REPL console to give you an idea of some of the code that can be written into your Python scripts. The same code, though, is going to be typed in at the console as would go inside your scripts. Installing it, we don't have to worry about installing it because it comes with it. If we just type the command Python itself at the command line, then we're going to run Python version 2.7. Python 3 is linked through to Python 3.2. When we look at writing code, be it at the console, be it in our file, readability is king. And one of the Zen elements of Python is readability counts. And we'll see how we can read the Zen of Python at our command line. So we've probably done enough talking about Python. Let's take a look and see how it works and where these Zen elements do fit in. So let's jump out of the slides now and we'll get into our Python REPL console. Now working through on the Raspberry Pi command line, you can see that I'm just running this as a standard user. And we'll get some understanding of how the command line environment is going to work for us and how it works with Python. As I say, we have both Python 2 and Python 3. If I run the command which Python, it then shows me that that points to usr bin Python, but that's a symbolic link. If I do a long listing of it, we can see that there's the L at the left-hand side indicating it's a link, as is the light blue or cyan color. And that's pointing to the program Python 2.7 in that same directory, usr bin Python. Now we can speed up this process by running both commands together. I'll show you what we mean. If we do an ls minus l on the output of which Python, we evaluate the brackets first and pass that through to ls minus l. So we can see that the process then gives us the same result, and I can just up arrow key now and do it with Python 3, and we can see that that's a symbolic link through to Python 3.2. So as we upgrade our versions of Pythons, if we went to, let's say, Python 3.3, we would just link that, or the system would link Python 3 through to 3.3. So it becomes a very simple mechanism of making sure that we're running the up-to-date version of the program that's installed on our machine. Control L just clears my screen, and then I can just type Python 3, so we'll use the latest version of Python, and this gives me my REPL console. And I can just start typing commands pretty much as I would, as if they were within a Python script. So if I do something like 2 multiplied by 3, then hopefully I get the result 6. But we can use that result from our REPL command line, and we can feed that into other sums, and that's represented by the underscore character. So if I did underscore plus 12, we really evaluate that as 6 plus 12. And then if I do underscore divided by 3, then we should get back to the number 6. So you can see how we can start using this within our command line. But I'd say the underscore, that result set, is only available to us at the command line. We can also use variables, so things like x equals 3 and y equals 5. Probably used to this from school and never understood it. But then we can do then x multiplied by 5, and then hopefully, yes, 15 is 3 multiplied by 15. So you can see that we can start using our proper coding techniques and using variables as the elements or targets for our arithmetic operations. But of course, we're not just restricted to simple mathematics. We can import functions, and one of those functions is a math function. Once we've imported it, then we can use functions from that module. So if we wanted to do something like calculate a square root or something like that, we could do math and then dot sqrt and then parentheses 144, close parentheses. So the square root of 144 is 12. And the parentheses is just the round brackets, as you can see, that we've used here. But it's not just numbers or integers that we can work with. We can work with string values as well. So to start seeing how our code is going to be properly and tidily formatted for readability, we're going to look at a simple looping structure using a for loop and looping through a list of names. So we can use something like for and then name. And name is just a variable that I've randomly assigned. It is going to be a list of name, but equally I could just call it cabbage, sausage or whatever. It doesn't really matter, it's just the choice, in the same way as I used X and Y before for my numbers. In, and then I'm going to create a list of names. Being string values, we can then put them into single quotes. So we have Bill, and then comma separate each one of the strings. So each string has its own set of single quotes, and to delimit the elements, we just use the comma. At the end of the line, we've got the two dots or the colon. This is indicating that we're entering a code block. We don't use brace brackets or anything like that. Again, we're trying to keep it empty and tidy. We use then four spaces to indent. I don't have to use four spaces, but that's the standard. But whatever I use to indent here, I've put in four spaces. But whatever I use, then I must be consistent within this code block. I can use two spaces, I can use three spaces, I can use four. As I say, four just happens to be the standard, but I have to stick with that within a code block. And we're then just going to print out our name variable and then return and return once more to just jump out of the code block. And then you can see we get our names coming back. I can use the up arrow key just to repeat that again if I want to. So again, within this REPL console, we've got the same features that we would normally have within a shell. Again, I can up arrow key and I can go through and we can put our four spaces in. We just build a little bit more into this. So we're going to print out some static text. So I'm going to have print and then my string, so the name. So this is going to be, if you like, a title that I'm going to print out. And just make sure that is a quote. And then we go through, we can use the print statement again. So print and open up our brackets. And then we're going to use name. But I can go name.upper. So it's going to translate it to uppercase. Print name.capitalize. So name.capitalize is going to uppercase the first character of the name. To be honest, I don't really need to use print. I could just go name.upper and name.capitalize. Remember, this whole thing with REPL is we read, evaluate, print and loop round. But this is where the four spaces become important. They all have to be lined up together. But you can see now the results that I'm getting out. So we can see how we can tidily create code within our REPL console and our scripts. So again, I can use Control L within the REPL console to clear my screen, and we're going to import the module this. And this will print out the Zen of Python by Tim Peters, as you can see, with really the design guidelines of what we should be aiming for. so sparse is better than dense, readability counts. We're really trying honestly to make the code readable. But hopefully this gives you an idea about Python, and I look forward to seeing you back on theurbanpenguin.com very soon. But I thank you for your time, and as I say, I look forward to welcoming you back very soon.